Dr. Uma Ramachandran, doctorate in ecology and environmental sciences. She has 22 years of diverse work experience that include technical assistance and coordination of various projects related to environment and biodiversity conservation, natural resource management, environmental impact assessment, socio-economic studies and poverty reduction. She is engaged with German International Cooperation Climate Change Project at the Department of Environment, Government of Tamil Nadu. She has served as ENVIS Coordinator at Environment Protection Training Research Institute, Senior Scientist at MS Swaminathan Research Foundation, in addition to being faculty for PG course on Preventive Environment Management, University of Hyderabad, and guest faculty at Anna University, Chennai. She is trained in various field-oriented techniques. She has been a resource person in several training programs. She has published many articles in national and international journals, newsletters, edited books, and proceedings.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series on environmental sciences. Now we are going to look at the portion on biodiversity. So today we will look at biodiversity, the concepts and conservation. The portions that will be covered right now is definition of biodiversity, levels of biodiversity, ecosystem, species and genetic diversity, the ecological pyramids and food chains and food web. So what does bio mean? All of us know that bio means living, and diversity is looking at the differences, the so much of variety and diversity that exists in the different living beings. So it means many varieties and variabilities that are existing. So we will exactly look at what this variety and variability actually means to all of you. So bio plus diversity is equal to biodiversity. So till now we are looking at this. Now what does biodiversity mean? Because we are looking at different varieties now, varieties of living organisms that we see around us. There are different life forms. If you look at a forest ecosystem, for instance, you have trees, you have plants, you have birds, you have for instance the aquatic beings like your fishes. So you have a variety of living beings. So you look at these different varieties, and this biodiversity actually refers to these different varieties. Then we look at actually the definition of biodiversity. So the best accepted the definition is biological diversity, which is the variety and variability that is existing among all the living organisms and the ecological complexes in which they occur. So this has been this is the most accepted definition. And biodiversity, in other words, for instance, the World Resources Institute 92, they have defined biodiversity as the totality of genes, species and ecosystems that exist in a region. Now we look at the other definitions too. There is much more to biodiversity than the number of species and kinds of ecosystems. So you find this ecologist Jerry Franklin, who portrays ecosystems as having three primary attributes, which is composition, structure and function, meaning every ecosystem has got a specific structure, a specific function and also a specific composition of the different species or living beings. Then we look at the different levels of biodiversity. So if you look at this diagram here, you find these three levels shown as three steps. So this is ecosystem, then you have the genetic and then the species. So these are the three levels of biodiversity: ecosystems diversity, genetic diversity and the species diversity. And when you take up ecosystem, for instance, that as defined in the earlier definition, it shows that every ecosystem has specific components, structure and function. And here when you look at the species, it refers to number of species that is existing per unit area, whatever given area we look at. And the genetic refers actually to the variety of genes that are existing within a living organism or within a species. And then the ecosystem, this refers to number of ecological niches per unit area, or other words, you can take it as variety of places where these different life exists. Therefore, we come back to what is biodiversity. We saw that bio plus diversity is equal to diversity. Now, this, after knowing that these are the three levels of biodiversity, we can come to this equation as biodiversity is equal to the genetic diversity, ecosystem diversity, and the species diversity. Now, when we look at genetic diversity, this refers to different types or varieties of genes, and genetic diversity refers to this variation that is existing within the species. So, this covers distinct populations of same species, such as thousands of traditional rice varieties in India. For instance, you take up the rice, the biological nomenclature, the scientific name of rice is Oryza sativa. But this Oryza sativa has got several varieties. So, for instance, you go to the Andaman Islands, you find Oryza sativa variety in Andamanica. This is a variety that is specific to the Andaman region. So, this is actually the distinction that we look at the populations around us, and or you can say the genetic variation within populations too, that which is high among the Indian rhinos and very low among the cheetahs. So, these genes, you know, what you look at this picture, they are actually the building blocks. And when you look at genetic diversity, we saw the example of rice. So, now when you look at these cats, for instance, this picture shows you different kinds of cats. They are all cats, but you find the fur, the coat color of the cats are varying, because every gene is responsible for a particular kind of a phenological or a phenotypic expression that is in the genes. So, then when you look at these different babies, you find that each baby looks very different. This is because of the variety of the genes that you see around in the living organisms. So, every gene refers to a specific kind of a function role. So, this gene actually is responsible for the kind of variation that is existing among the living organisms. Then we go to species diversity. Now, this refers to variety of species within a region. So, such diversity can be measured in many ways, and scientists, they have not settled on one single best method, because there are many methods to arrive at it. The number of species in a region is actually referred to as the species richness, how rich a region is in the different species. So, and is one often is used measure is, but a more precise measurement, this is one type. The other more precise measurement is taxonomic diversity. This also considers the relationship of the species to each other. Okay, so if you take a particular forest region, you find a set of species existing there. And you can probably compare, for instance, a terrestrial region with an aquatic region or a coastal area where the mangroves exist. You find that there is a complete difference in the kind of species composition that is existing in a terrestrial region. When you look at also the coastal region, you find again it has got a specific kind of a species. This actually species richness is, if you take measurements, if you take measurements in a particular area, you find that there are different number of species, which also refers to the taxonomic diversity we just looked at. So, this taxonomic diversity itself will show you that there is the area is so much rich, so much species rich. For example, we take a specific example, island with two species of birds, okay, one island with two species of birds and one species of lizard. Now, this has got a greater taxonomic diversity than an island with three species of birds, but has got no lizards. So, when you compare one and two, one is more diverse because though it has got the less number of lizards, there are, you find two species of birds which are additional. So this is how we look at the species diversity. Now this picture shows for instance variety of mangoes. You know that mango is a very common fruit, Mangifera indica. So this has got different varieties of species. You call it Alfonza, you call it Banganapalli. So you have different species. So now we look at the ecosystem diversity. So before looking at the ecosystem diversity, we will see what exactly is meant by ecosystem. Now here this ecosystem, this is formed by the interaction of a group of many individuals belonging to different organisms or species, also called as community, with their physical environment. So this has got a particular structure, particular components and also functions, which actually means that in an ecosystem you have different living organisms. So there is a lot of interaction and interlinkage between these living organisms. So these refers to the biotic components, and these living or biotic components, they interact with the physical environment, in other words the abiotic components. So these components refer to, for instance, water, soil and so on. In fact, soil is partly also biotic because you have the soil microbes that are contained in it. But whatever it is, ecosystem refers to all the interactions that is happening among the biotic components, and they in turn interact with the abiotic and the abiotic components and the physical environment. So this every ecosystem, if you look at every ecosystem, it is, every ecosystem is different. Just like how every species is different and every genes or genetic variation is there, is different in many species, you also find that the ecosystem also varies, and there are, you have lots of types of ecosystems. So these ecosystems, they have a specific structure, they have also a set of components that are very specific to that particular ecosystem, and also a specific function. So our next slide looks at ecosystem or habitat diversity. You can also call it as a habitat diversity. So different types of ecosystem, okay. So ecosystem diversity, this encompasses variety of habitats that occur within a region, or the mosaic of patches that is found within a landscape. For example, you find variety of habitats and environmental parameters that constitute, for instance, a delta ecosystem. Then you have variety of structure, function and components in a grassland ecosystem, variety of structure, function and components in a wetland ecosystem, or a river ecosystem, estuarine ecosystem. Estuarines are where the mangroves are present. So these estuaries are places where the sea water and the fresh water mixes, and these are rich, one of the most productive ecosystems in the world are these estuarine ecosystems, because they contribute a lot in terms of fisheries. The other additional benefits are they act as excellent windbreaks. They help in controlling the soil, the sea erosion. For instance, recently there have been instances of tsunami in Chennai. Mangroves would be a great help in looking at these kind of containing these kind of stresses. Let's go for a short break and we'll get back to this. Welcome back after the break. Just before the break, we were looking at what exactly is meant by biodiversity. We have looked at the different definitions of biodiversity, then the different levels of biodiversity, and we've stopped at the ecosystem diversity. So we will now continue from there. As I had mentioned, you find that it is there is a lot of variation in the ecosystems too. It looks different. For instance, a mountain looks completely different from a pond and so on. Okay, so here we have looked at the ecosystem diversity. So this next slide shows the ecosystems of India. You will be really astonished to know that every type of ecosystem is represented in our country. You find, for instance, in this picture, the mountain ecosystem right at the top. You have the wetland ecosystem here, the mangrove ecosystem, and then you have island ecosystem, the coral reef ecosystems, the marine ecosystems, the forest ecosystem, and also the desert ecosystem. So you find that every type that is known is represented in India. So it's a very glad to know that our country has got such a variety of ecosystems. Now, when you look at an ecosystem, I was talking to you about these different interactions that is happening among the living organisms, and everything is interlinked in the form of a chain. So food chain is nothing but, you are looking at a food chain now. So the food chain is nothing but the process of eating and being eaten up, to make it very simple. So this diagram, you find that the solar energy, the sun, the solar energy is the driving force, and the plants, they produce food. So they are known as producers. So they have the capacity to produce food by the process of photosynthesis. And then you find these other animals which eat upon these plants, and these are in turn being eaten up by the other higher up animals. So here down in this picture, you find that from the producers, you have the solar energy, then water in the form of rain. So producers, they have produced their own food. Now that is eaten up by a small hare. Then you have the consumer. These are all the first level consumers. They are all plant eating organisms. So you call them herbivores. So here you find the consumers, which is a herbivore, and then you have the other consumers too, the omnivore. Okay, omnivores, they eat both the plants as well as other animals. And you have carnivores, which feed only on other animals, and then the detrivores, which actually eat up whatever is left up, and also they are very important in recycling back the minerals back to the environment, because they act upon the dead organic matter, the dead living matter. So, and then it all goes back to to the soil, and then you again this is a cycle which keeps on continuing. So this is a food chain that you see in this picture. And then now it is not just one single food chain that is operating in the environment. You have several food chains, and all these several food chains are actually interlinked. So here you find in this picture so many different food chains, and everything is interlinked. And finally you find the water nutrients, it goes back as nutrients, and again you find it keeps on, it's a continuous cycle. So this is another picture of the food web that you are looking at. So A is actually eaten by B, and so on. So you have many organisms. Okay, so this is actually called as the food web. Okay, a number of chains, food chains put together, refers to the food web. So different ecosystems have different set of living organisms like this. Different food webs are existing. So this is to show you what exactly is the food chain and food web. Now we look at what is called as the ecological pyramids. So you just have a look at this picture. You find that when you actually put all the living, try and imagine and put all the living organisms in the form of a pyramid, you find that at the end you have the producers, then you have the different consumers that you look at here. So these different regions or levels, they are actually called as the trophic levels in a community. When you look at what is meant by community, we'll just look at this slide which explains what a community is. So here, this is an example of one example of an ecosystem, which is a pond ecosystem. So you have a small pond here, you have some aquatic plants, and you have organisms within this pond ecosystem, and each one is being eaten up by the other. The fishes, the small animals and so on are eaten up, and finally you have the detritivorous organisms at the end of the bottom of the pond, and they actually act upon the dead matter that is there in the pond, and it actually gives back nutrients to the pond. This picture here shows you the difference between a population and a community. Population is nothing but a number of individuals that belong to one single species, whereas a community refers to many number of species that is existing in a region. So, a population means, for instance, it is A, whereas in community you find A, B, C, many individuals of A, many individuals of B, and many individuals of C. Now, when we come to the ecological pyramids, so this actually looks at the different trophic levels that is existing in the community. You have producers in this diagram, you find the producers right at the bottom. Then you have primary level of consumers or the primary consumers, then you have secondary consumers and the tertiary consumers, which are right at the top. So, most ecological pyramids therefore are large at the base and narrow at the top. This is because every time that an organism is eaten by the next trophic level, some of the energy is also lost as heat. Okay? So, more energy is existing here and less energy at the top. This is again the diagram of the food chain to show you the different trophic levels, that is your producers, consumers and so on. And yet another picture of these different levels of consumers. So, here in this picture you find that there is a comparison of a terrestrial food chain and a marine food chain. So, here at the left you have plants, then you have these herbivores, you have carnivores, different levels of carnivores and so on. So, here in the marine food chain at the right, you see the picture showing a phytoplankton because these are all aquatic, it is an aquatic ecosystem. So, basically you have a terrestrial ecosystem and also aquatic ecosystem. So, this diagram gives you the difference between a terrestrial and the aquatic ecosystem in the form of the different levels, trophic levels. So, phytoplanktons, and then you find the zooplankton, the carnivores, the different levels of carnivores. So, therefore, primary producers are right at the bottom, then you have the primary consumers, the secondary consumers, tertiary and the quaternary consumers. And when you look at the other picture on the right, you find that the primary producers are right here, primary consumers, the human vegetarians, and then secondary consumers, human beings are omnivores because we eat both the plant and also the animals. So, here you find again the different trophic levels too. Here in between you find cattle, and then you find the omnivores, the secondary level of consumers. Now, when you look at the ecological types of ecological pyramids, we saw what an ecological pyramid is. We are now going to look at what are the different types of ecological pyramids. All of you would have heard about the law of thermodynamics. Okay? So, it states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. Always, there are times when there is a change of energy from one one form to another form, but each time when this change in energy occurs, there is definitely a loss of energy in the form of heat. Okay, so now we pick up the first pyramid, which is the pyramid of numbers. Okay, so this picture shows the illustration of number of organisms at each trophic level. So, here we find, for instance, this is a Michigan bluegrass field, the number of individual organisms. So, here you find that the primary producers are right at the base and it is so broad and wide at the bottom. And then you have the primary consumers, secondary consumers, and then the tertiary consumers, the different trophic levels. Always you find that the producers are always more in number. So the base is always more wider, and the tip is always narrower. So therefore you have number of individuals maximum at the bottom and minimum at right at the tip of this pyramid. So this is the pyramid of numbers. Now we move on to pyramid of biomass. So now this pyramid of biomass indicates the amount of biomass in each trophic level. Okay, so biomass weight is actually determined after dehydration, that is you remove the moisture content and then the biomass is actually arrived at. So this shows the amount of matter that is lost between the trophic levels. So this is the picture. Here you find, when you look at the dry weight of each of these, always the producers will weigh much more than the top of the pyramid. This also comes back to the same concept, the base being wider and the tip being narrower. The third pyramid we are looking at is the pyramid of energy. So this shows that the energy available at each trophic level. So the size of the blocks actually represents the proportion of productivity in this picture, and this is measured in joules or calories. So here this diagram shows you the energy levels at each of the trophic level. So here right at the bottom you have primary producers, the primary consumers, the secondary consumers and the tertiary consumers, and you will find again here that the energy that is existing is the highest at the base and very little at the tip. So there's one more picture showing you the pyramid of energy. So most of the energy available to the community is always in the first trophic level. Only 10 to 20% energy is available to the next trophic level, which means about 90 to 80% loss of energy is there. So therefore it is better that you be a vegetarian. So now this picture, this shows what kind of pyramid is this. You just have a look at this and arrive at what kind of a pyramid, what is happening here. So here you find that the primary producers are right at the bottom, and then you find a lot of phytoplanktons, and these primary consumers, they eat all these phytoplanktons. And then here you find the secondary consumers, where actually these eat the smaller animals. And right at the top you find the tertiary consumers, and these actually eat the small predators. So therefore this is a pyramid again which is in line with the ecological pyramid concept that we saw. So now energy, the trophic levels are measured here in kilocalories. Now when you look at the human population growth, see, we are talking of biodiversity, ecosystems and so on, but what is happening to the population growth? How can more people be supported on earth when there is a limited supply of resources? So it depends on what they are eating, and this actually shows the different levels. Okay, and it requires 10 times as many crops to feed animals being bred for meat consumption as it would to feed the amount of people on a vegetarian diet. So the US actually could feed 800 million people with the grain that livestock eat. Let us quickly summarize what we have done so far. We have looked at the concept of biodiversity, the actually what is meant by biodiversity. Then we have looked at the definitions and some of the types of biodiversity and levels of biodiversity, and also the concepts of ecosystem, what exactly is meant by food chain, food web, and what is also meant by the ecological pyramids, and what is happening, like if you imagine the different living organisms in the form of a pyramid, what is exactly happening to the numbers, to the biomass and to the energy levels. Let us look at some questions related to the topic that we have just discussed. So the first question is, how do you define biodiversity? Second question is, what are the different levels of biodiversity? The third question is, how do you define an ecosystem? Fourth question is, what is the difference between a food chain and a food web? And the fifth question is, what are the different types of ecological pyramids? So this concludes our this session relating to biodiversity. We will look at the other portions under this chapter during the next few sessions. Thank you.